welcome Associate Teaching Professor of Computer Science at University of California, San Diego, and General Co-Chair of the Grace Hopper Celebration 2015, Christine Alvarado.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. I hope you've all enjoyed the last 2 days of GHC as much as I have. Right now, I'm thrilled to introduce our next speaker, Professor Manuela Veloso. Manuela is the Herbert A. Simon University Professor in the Computer Science Department at Carnegie Mellon University. She also holds courtesy appointments at the Robotics Institute. Manuela has conducted important research in robotics and artificial intelligence. Manuela is also the director of the CORAL Research Laboratory for the study of autonomous agents that collaborate, observe, reason, act, and learn. Manuela is also an IEEE Fellow, a AAAS Fellow, and a AAAI Fellow. Pretty impressive. She was also the previous president of AAAI and RoboCup. Please join me in welcoming Manuela Veloso to the stage.
Christine, for the introduction, and thank you for having me. So I'll tell you today about this concept of robots and robot autonomy. So we all share here at Grace Hopper this passion for computing. We care about data, we care about algorithms, we care about programs. Efficiency is something that we learn in all our courses in computer science, and we also have this concept of automation, autonomy. So through this talk, we are going to delve into what is this concept of autonomy. So humans, at least I am not remote controlled, and I don't think that any of you is. And so we have this feature of autonomy because we actually can see, we have perception, we actually think, and we move. So we have these three kind of capabilities, the fact that we can perceive the world, make decisions, learn, and actually actuate. So in my research in AI and robotics, this is what we pursue. It's this quest for these autonomous, intelligent robots that exhibit these same three capabilities in a seamless integration. So the fact that they can actually perceive the world, they have sensors, they can make decisions by themselves, algorithms that decide, turn left, go right, move forward, and eventually then they actually move. So the machines we are talking about, these robots, are equipped then with sensors. And these sensors are LiDAR, range finders, or Kinect cameras, and then they have reasoning, and the reasoning is the computation that goes on board of their laptops, and eventually they also have wheels or legs. And so somehow they can move, and also they can have a speech synthesis, so they can speak, they can gesture if they had arms, and therefore they are these kind of laptop on wheels and a camera. And this is a cobot robot at Carnegie Mellon that moves in our buildings, and it's capable of going from any position to another position by itself. So nobody is, again, remote controlling this robot, and the robot magically, in some sense, beautifully, arrives at its destination. So we are going to delve for about two or three slides on this problem of actually understanding what does it mean for a robot to move by itself. We are full of technology around us. We have cell phones, we have computers, but where are the robots? Did you see any robots here at Grace Hopper? Well, I didn't. So somehow we are still missing the technology that can actually move by itself. Yes, there are Roombas. Yes, there are beams in which you can telepresence yourself. but robots that actually move by themselves are not as common. So let's think about the problem. So one of the main problems is this concept of robot localization. And I'm going just to explain to you very simply, what does this mean? So you understand also the core of this mobile robot problem. So these robots are equipped with a map, which is just a floor plan of a building. They could have learned the map, or they can be given just a plain PDF file, which is then translated into a data structure that is capable of having like distances between corridors, between walls, and the robot is equipped with a sensor, which in our case, it's a Kinect, and I'll explain what the Kinect is. And, very good, and actually then it has a motion model of its own motors. So you have to understand that if you close your eyes, we have a model of how much we can move forward, and we can estimate our position by actually our own motion model, then we may open our eyes, and we may see landmarks at some distance, so we know better where we are. That's the same concept of the algorithm that a robot uses. So let's just delve into the sensing problem. So there is a Kinect, and the Kinect, a wonderful device that is used also to play games, but in robotics, it's a camera that actually provides you with not only the color of pixels, but the distance at which this sensor receives obstacles from the world. So actually that distance received from the sensor is a cloud of points. We called it a point cloud in the 3D space. So it looks like something like this, and you probably can see what this scene is. It's like a desk. But the problem from a computational point of view is that this is too many points, too much to process from a computational point of view. So my student Joydeep Biswas, who did a thesis on this robot localization, we invented this algorithm in which the way to solve this problem is by sampling the image. You sample this point cloud. You compute the normal of those 3 points. You throw 3 points at the image. You compute the normal. And the normal defines a plane. And then you do this many times, and you find the planes in the image. And this is an algorithm that's a fast sampling plane filtering. And why do we care about planes? It's because walls are planar. The ground is planar. And the robot will need to identify those planes to know where it is in the map. Here is an example of this computation in which you can see on the left the actual raw point cloud as it comes from the Kinect, and on the right this algorithm sampling and computing these normals such that planes in the image are identified. And here is the robot moving in space, and here it's like the raw image again, the point cloud, and the robot moving with some uncertainty, but then it checks and gets this little bit of a wall and eventually finds this corner and it knows where it is. And the uncertainty of its localization is reduced and the robot moves such that it knows where it is. So when you now see a robot moving in space, you can, in your head, run this algorithm. The robot is processing this sensing these depth images, extracting planes, mapping to a map that it has about the distance of the corridors, and figuring out that it actually knows where it is. And here is a very beautiful example of how do you know that the robot actually knows where it is, because at the end of this corridor, there is a transition between wooden floor and carpet. And in that transition, in the map that the robot has, it says that it should slow down when it gets to that bump, so that the computer and everything works fine. And look how it slowed down right there at the right location. And that's really beautiful. Thank you. And here it goes, and you see how different this is. And I just want to show that's Joydeep on the left. So another thing is that very beautifully, these robots, while they move in the building, are capable of capturing data. And this is very important because we are using these mobile platforms to be sensors, mobile sensors. Grace Hopper had a very beautiful track on Internet of Things. These are sensors, but these are sensors that move in the building, and they collect data. And because they are so well localized, they can generate maps of what is the strength of Wi-Fi, for example, in every single point in the building. And those are then used to plan where to put access points. They can be used to algorithm for networking. And this has been the thesis of my student Richard Wang on trying to understand how to use a mobile robot to actually gather very accurate data about Wi-Fi or temperature or humidity or any other condition of the environment through the localization of the robot. Okay, so this is the first part of the talk, in which now you became all experts in robot localization and in mobile robotics, okay? So you kind of know a robot that moves is computing its position. It needs to know its position to be able to turn left and right. It's not really seeing exactly that the name, the numbers on the wall, on the doors of the offices, it's hard to do that, and therefore it does some other algorithm, but it knows where it is. However, even if these robots move beautifully in our environments, they have limitations. Well, guess what? They cannot go upstairs. They definitely yet, even with lots of machine learning, they cannot open all the doors of the world. And this, from a research point of view, has been like a kind of like a setback. So when are they going to be able to be really autonomous, these robots? They cannot, they have these inevitable limitations. They cannot press elevator buttons. Cobot doesn't have arms. It could have, it might have one day, but it could not then pick up all the objects. So it doesn't have arms, but it has something that's really nice, which is a basket. A basket is a great feature because they can carry things from one place to another. But in order to handle this problem of all these limitations, we invented a new concept. We created this concept of symbiotic autonomy. The robots ask for help. When they can't do something, they ask for help. They ask for help from the humans around, they ask for help from the web, and they ask for help from other robots. So this is the message that you need to understand, is that technology, if it has limitations, could be still autonomous, but could say, hey, human, you know, I need help here. Can you help me? And here is an example when the robot at the beginning could not traverse this glass bridge. We didn't have enough sensing, no sensing algorithms. It would say, I will follow you instead. Is there any human I can follow? And when the human would show up, it said, can I follow you? And there you go, yeah. And it would follow the bridge, get to the other side and said, thank you, I don't need you anymore. Now I can go. The same thing happens at the elevator. This robot goes and says, let me just put the sound. Can you please push the up button and hold the elevator door? And you know, humans are generous, and this is not a difficult thing to do. And they press the elevator button. This is Stephanie Rosenthal. And it can also not sense very well whether it's the elevator on the right and the elevator on the left, and it also asks, can you please tell me which elevator it came? And Stephanie says, the right one. And beautifully, it goes into the elevator by itself. So it doesn't need help to go into the elevator. And when it's in the elevator, it says, can you please press 8 and tell me when I get to that floor? And the human nicely says, you are on 8, and there it goes. I'm done. I don't need any more. So, thank you. So, you know, this is a kind of a, somehow, I cannot say a revolution, but it's some kind of a novel way of looking at this issue about autonomy, because they are autonomous, but they cannot do everything. And therefore, when these algorithms know that parts of the task are really not feasible, they just ask for help. So maybe some of you have this question in mind. So what happens if someone says that the robot is on 8? Or what happened and it's not? Or what happens if the robot stands by the elevator? Can you please push the elevator button? And nobody pushes the elevator button. Or what happens if the robot asks for help and nobody helps? Does that occur to you? I guess so. But guess what? They still do another thing. They send us email if that happens. And they say, I've waited for more than 5 minutes for a response to the question. Hello, I'm here to guide you to room 7002, which happens to be my office. Please press done when you are ready to go. Can someone please come to this location to answer the question so that I can complete my task? Which means I've been here waiting. This is what I'm supposed to do. Nobody helped me. And now it asks help from remote humans. It sends email. Or I've been blocked by an obstacle for more than 3 minutes. Can someone please come to this place to rescue me because I'm here stuck? Actually, the robot is very good at obstacle avoidance, so it stands in front of someone and says, please excuse me, please excuse me. If the person doesn't get it out of the way, there is no problem. You can stand in front of it. The only problem is that the robot, after 3 minutes or five, 3 minutes I think is the deadline, sends us email. And then the interesting thing is that, so there's a lab where my students are, there's my office, we are all in different offices. It sends email to all of us. It's a group of like 15 people. And I even sometimes, I can be in the middle of a class if I get this email, I say, but hold on a second, where is Cobot? And so, and it doesn't happen many times, like I would say 20 times a year. So people are very friendly and they are very helpful. If the robot says 10 times, please excuse me, you do get out of the way. And the beautiful thing here also is that we also like coordinate and say, okay, Joydeep, can you go and help the robot? Yeah, I'm on my way. And there is this concept of, again, that we don't need to supervise the robot. We don't need to follow the robot. It's a major experience to really see this robot leave my office, which is at the end of a corridor. And when it comes to the end of the corridor, it turns, and I cannot see it anymore. And at the beginning, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, the first time this happened, I tended to rush to see where is it and run behind it. But now I know that I will not see it, and then I will not hear it anymore, because for a while, when I don't see, I still hear its motors working, and I know it's fine. But then the lab, or wherever it goes, the building is big, and I cannot hear nor see. And I just have to say, it's on its own. If it needs help, it will ask. If it doesn't need help, it will get to its destination. So this concept of helping a robot became also the thesis of Stephanie Rosenthal, and she introduced this concept of having robots now think about the humans that can help them. So instead of planning only for the best path in distance, which used to be the only objective function that path planning would use for robot motion, it can also use locations where humans may help the robot more. And so now you optimize best in distance and in potential human helper. If I really need help, these offices here have people that are very kind to me. They always help me. And therefore, I'm going to go around those offices in case I need help. I know those people are helpers, or that they have a profile of helping me more than over there. And so, in some sense, there is this study about how humans help and all this human-robot interaction that Stephanie Rosenthal was very passionate about, and tried to understand how that such human thinking could be incorporated into the planning of the robot, and therefore this thesis on human-centered planning, not just distance, not just terrain, not just all of these, but then humans become also part of the planning of this robot. So these robots have moved at Carnegie Mellon for more than 1,000 kilometers by themselves. And 1,000 kilometers is a distance like here in Texas, I don't know very much how much, but you can imagine this more like from Pittsburgh, the western side of Pennsylvania, all the way to Boston, up there in the northeastern side of the United States. So it's a very long distance, and they have moved consistently. And many people at Carnegie Mellon, if not everyone, knows these robots. And people come to my office always escorted by Cobot for the last 3 years. So if you come and you visit me, I will not give you directions how to come to my office, but I will say, don't worry, Cobot will meet you at the elevator hall and will bring you to my office. And some people get a little bit insecure about this concept of a robot bringing them to my office, but then it's an amazing experience to be really escorted to my office by this autonomous robot. So this is kind of the second part of understanding that robots ask for help from humans, but they also need to interact with humans through language. And this language problem, again, leads into things that they don't understand. So you can tell this robot, go to the lab, and somehow LAB, lab, processed by the great speech recognition techniques that our Googles and our Apple made available, may still not, the robot may not have a location in the map that corresponds to the word lab. So the robots engage on this dialogue with people, where should I go? And eventually either put a map of the building on their screen so people can say where this is, or they ask for a room number. And until this dialogue leads to a location that the robot knows how to go, the robot doesn't move, because LAB, lab, doesn't mean anything. But after some time, they learn these locations. They also learn to go to the web to find out what things that people say mean. For example, if I ask the robot, bring me coffee, bring me a chocolate, bring me a binder, bring me a stapler, can you please check if like there is a tea in the kitchen? All these references to objects, coffee, chocolate, binder, tea, book, memory stick, are not things that we have told the robot where they can be found. So the robot, actually, through the thesis of one of my students, Mehdi Samada, uses this algorithm that is object eval, that is able to go to the web and get the probability that these objects are in specific locations that it knows about. So the robot knows about categories like kitchen, office, conference room, and bathroom, and elevators, and all sorts of like locations on the building. And through this object eval, is able to find out what's the most probable location for a particular object. So here is an example, and here is where we need the sound.
Please bring a copy to the lab.
This is Tom Collar.
This object is not in my knowledge base. I will search the web using object eval to see if the object is in location, kitchen, office, meeting room, or printer room. Object eval returns high probability for object copy in location office and also for object copy in location kitchen. Which location you think is best?
Kitchen.
I will collect the object copy and deliver it at the lab. Room 7412. Is that correct?
Yes.
And here it goes now. It has everything. See? So the interesting thing is that through this dialogue with the person, now it knows how to move. It now I have where I should go, I have where I should pick up, and there it's going happily to the kitchen to pick up coffee. But it doesn't have arms, so it gets to the kitchen, and again,
hello.
It says, hello,
could you please put
this object coffee in my basket and press then when I'm ready to go. And this is Mehdi Samadi, and there you go, Mehdi nicely puts the coffee on the basket, says goodbye, and there goes the robot. So. And, yeah. And then the robot goes to its destination, which is this lab, and gets
hello.
To the lab and
I
says,
have
I have brought the coffee coffees from the kitchen. And, okay, please press done when I can go. And again, like the robot, thank you. Robin Soten said, thing picks up, and there you go. So this is actually a video. And as you know, it's a video. But it happens at CMU. You can go there and ask the robot to do anything. And the robot will eventually, will eventually dialogue with you or go to the web or go to its knowledge base until it finds what is this object, where is this location. And if you go to my website, you have plenty of these videos to watch. But what's nice about this also is that the robot actually learns and saves this information. This is a raw data. We are all computer scientists, so we can appreciate raw data. This is a file in which we save object grounds to coffee 7602, which happens to be the location of the kitchen. And the robot acquires all this knowledge by interacting with people. So it learns from going to the web, it learns from talking with people, it asks for help, becomes this symbiotic autonomy. Finally, we are not in the one robot problem. We are actually developing many robots. So at CMU, there are 4 cobots. They move everywhere. In fact, we only have 3 now because Joydeep Biswas is now an assistant professor at the University of Massachusetts at Amherst, and he took 1 cobot with him. So we have 3 at Carnegie Mellon and 1 at UMass. And where does this multi-robot come from? Well, you may know, or if you don't know, you may know that I've been doing also robot soccer for many years. And this robot soccer, this team in particular, this year, is the world champion of RoboCup Small Size League. And I'm going to tell you and show you a couple of videos of this robot soccer for you to understand this issue about teamwork. And here it is. So let me prepare you for this. There is always a goal at the end, so you don't have to worry about, are they going to score? They are, okay? So done with that. So we can put our computer science hat and not soccer or anything like that. And it's also it's quite fast. So it's going to be hard for you to follow balls and robots and so forth. But don't worry, because I'll show you once the video, and then I show the video slow down by a factor of half a factor, and I'll explain everything. So we can enjoy, but from a computer science point of view, here is a robot, and there is a ball that you'll see coming up there. There's a pass, another pass, a shoot at the goal. Eventually, there's another pass. That robot misses the ball, but then eventually shoots from there. Do you understand? And what you have to realize, this is extremely challenging, because you have to realize that, believe it or not, this is all a computer program coming up with this, with these positions, with this processing, where are the robots from vision. It's all machines being autonomous, playing a very complex problem, which is this manipulating a ball and moving from place to place. And here is what happens in terms of the algorithm. There's the robot that actually decides to pass to this one with a chip kick. There comes the ball in the air. And now this one has a choice of either passing the ball to that robot or shooting. There's the ball, comes to this one. This one is going to pass it back to that one because it's being like attacked by... And now there is an open goal, and there's an open shot, and it shoots at the goal, predicts immediately where the ball is going to go, moves there, and it's going to pass to that robot, passes the ball to that robot misses the pass, unexpectedly, this is hardware and robotics, and eventually goes back and gets an open goal and shoots at the goal. And all of this also is Juan Pablo Mendoza that has done all these animations to explain exactly what the algorithms are doing. And it's not remote controlled. And it's not that we have seen this particular play ever before. And it's an algorithm planning all of these and coming up with all the possible choices and making these decisions for the robots to move autonomous. One more example. And here is the robot again receiving the ball and making all these computations. What should it do? decides to pass to that robot. This is called a pass ahead. Another pass ahead, and eventually this robot passes the ball and you score from there. Understand? So this is fundamental for this understanding of robot soccer in terms of teamwork combined with great individual skills. So this is actually why when my robots, my cobot robots, couldn't do everything by themselves, I had been in this teamwork kind of like thinking for many years. And so for me, it was, in some sense, very natural to come up with this concept of they will ask for help, they will have to rely on someone else, be it humans, be it the web, because there is an understanding that also from an autonomy point of view, from an understanding now, that no single machine is going to be able to do it all by itself. We'll have to rely on this cyber world, all the internet, on this social world, all these humans, and we are developing systems that should be cyber, physical, social systems. And all these three components will play a role in terms of making automation reach levels that were never reached before. So wherever you are in your companies, you have to think about these sensors and about these computers and about these people and about sensors talking with other sensors. And all this automation will reach a level that we really can make a difference in life. So here is a final example of the robots helping each other. So here is Cobot 2 that goes to, let me just explain. So actually these cobots, because they're more than one, they are talking with each other. We don't see them talk with each other, but when one is in the seventh floor and the other one is the ninth floor on the fourth floor, they actually share information between them. So when Cobot 2 needs to go some office A, it doesn't matter, some number of office, it told the other cobots that are in the building, I'm going to office A. So what makes here the difference is that when Cobot 2 tells this, Cobot 4 happens to be in this vicinity of this office A, and when it goes by, checks, oh, but the door is closed. So at that moment, it tells Cobot 2 that the door is closed. So shares this information with the other cobot. And Cobot 2, when it's like going on its way to that office, finds that the door is closed and replans to do another task. And so this is absolutely remarkable that you see these robots interacting and being able to recompute their routes, to replan their routes, because they're all talking with each other. Yes, they are not passing balls like in the soccer, they are not scoring goals, but they are in our environments, not in a play field. They are in our environments communicating, sharing tasks between them, and this is also the thesis of my student Brian Colton, who is currently at NASA, and you have to understand something about Brian Colton. He created also these, for this transportation by multiple robots, the ability to have these robots transfer items from one to another. So what comes about this transfer, and let me go with you over this example very briefly. So if you think that there are robots like with these stars, one, two, and three robots, just focus on the stars. And one, two, and three, the colors is like the three robots, and they are in different locations in this floor plan. And they have to eventually take some other objects, these objects two, three, and five, these square things are objects. Brian comes up with an algorithm that is capable of planning routes for robots where they meet and they transfer items from one to the other. They ask for being transferred so that the total route is minimized. So for example, this robot would here in this position meet the robot three and pass this object, this is a little transfer triangle, such that because these object one and two and four all need to come to this side. So you don't need to have the robots all navigate to the positions because they meet themselves somewhere and then they go. So Brian actually applied these to data real data of taxes in San Francisco and in New York City, and he would say that if people would be willing to transfer from one taxi to another when we are all stopped in some light to go to LaGuardia, we would save tons of time and energy. So now it's a different concept. It's not carpooling. It's actually this concept of planning routes such that we meet there and the driver, the autonomous car, would say, "Hey, switch to the other car, please." And we would switch to the other car, and then only one car goes with three people, four people, two people, all the way to LaGuardia. Why send two individual cars all the way to the airport? So the same thing happens on the robot. And the reason why I'm giving you this example about the taxis in New York and the taxis in San Francisco is because many of these algorithms, many of these procedures that we developed for robots end up applying to other types of data, to other types of problems. And therefore, in particular, this thesis of Brian Colton with this, you know, multi-robot pickup and delivery problems, which is what cobots do, is very applicable to other transportation and navigation tasks that you may find. So here it is, the robots moving at CMU. And this is a scene that you can see if you come to CMU. Here we actually gave them tasks so that they would be like here one after another. Usually we don't see them like so lined up. We kind of meet them in places in the building. But this is like what eventually their coordination, the views that you have to expect in a few years is that you would enter a conference hall like this one and there would be robots moving around the same way that there are people moving around. So in addition, we also care a lot about robots with different capabilities, so what we call heterogeneous robots. And in particular, there is the Baxter, built by a company Rethink Robotics, a famous robot, really very functional, very accessible, both in terms of price and programming. And Rethink Robotics, built by a company led by Rodney Brooks, is this robot that has manipulation and can be programmed to manipulate objects, but doesn't move. It's on a base that we cannot move unless we put the actual robot on top of some mobile robot. So we have Baxter that has hands but can't move, and we have Cobot that doesn't have hands but can move. So there is this coordination between the two such that Baxter can use Cobot's basket to send things to other places that it can't reach. So we have been developing also algorithms for the coordination between these actuators and sensors with different capabilities. Maybe a temperature sensor needs to talk with a distance sensor, and eventually an actuator that can pick up things talks with an actuator that can move things, and maybe your shower will talk with your toaster, and then someone will take your keys all the way. Who knows? So what you have to understand is that somehow technology is also about diversity. It's about having things that can do things that other things can't do. So it's not that we all have a piece of code that does everything. It's the science of these integration of capabilities is something that should be also on our path on research, on development. How do we not have to do it all in some company while we can, or in some research lab, but we still can put things together? So in conclusion, we would love to have these robots be part of our environments, be more common. And you need to go and think, yes, we love cell phones and we love computers and we love the web, but we have to move one step up and have things that move by themselves, that can help. If you are in a hospital and you have someone there, you can say, "Oh, please go and get the referral while I'm here with this person." Or you can take while someone is waiting in some wait room, "Oh, I'll get you some coffee while you wait." "Oh, I'll watch this person while you do this." "Oh, I'll pick up this for you." This kind of concept, you drive by the supermarket and there is someone that goes, and, "Oh, can you fill up this shopping list? That's it, I cannot." And then the robot comes and brings you everything. What is this concept of having humans, dogs, cats, and robots? You know, so it's like a new kind of understanding that we have to reach, and I am working on that. So there you go. Symbiotic autonomy enables these humans, robots, web, this coexistence, this coordination, this distribution of service, hopefully for the mutual benefit of all of us. So I really think that artificial intelligence and robotics are fascinating areas of research and development. So I thank you very much, and I wish you all the best to all these grace hoppers. Thank you very much.